So we're ready to start the calculations associated with insoluble salts. And being able to go between what we call molar solubility, which would be its solubility in moles per liter, and the Ksp value. Now, as we go through these problems, I'm hoping that you're starting to see patterns emerge. We're going to see variations that we that play out when we're dealing with this, but it shouldn't all be brand new to you if you're understanding these calculations as we go. All right, so Ksp is just one way of talking about how soluble a salt is. Okay, we can make comparisons between them. So the smaller the Ksp value, that means the equilibrium lies farther to the left. And let me write a reaction here for just a moment. Let's say our salt is lead chloride, PbCl2. According to the solubility rules, that's an insoluble salt. So you have your ions on the right. Now let's see why it would make sense that the smaller the Ksp value, the less soluble it is. What does a small k tell you about which way this equilibrium lies? The smaller it is, the farther it lies to the left, and the less ions you're going to have in solution. So the magnitude of Ksp is one way. Now you cannot compare things that have very different formulas with their Ksps too well, but if you had a bunch of different formulas that had a 1-to-2 ratio between the cation and the anion, then you could make a judgment of which one's more soluble and which one's less soluble. Now, why do they have to have a 1-to-2 ratio to make comparisons to the lead chloride? Well, it's because you're raising things to the power of their coefficients, and their concentrations are impacted differently if those squares and those cubes might be in there. All right. But you wouldn't just necessarily look at Ksp. You could take it one step further and you could express solubility. You could determine the solubility of that substance. Molar solubility, which is abbreviated with a lowercase s, is by definition the number of moles of the solute that will dissolve in a saturated solution. Okay? So it's how much of this you can get to dissolve in a liter. How much of this in moles per liter did you get to dissolve? And that's called molar solubility. So we see three boxes down there at the bottom. And what this is telling me is if I know one of the, either the Ksp, I can get to the molar solubility. And if I know the molar solubility, I can get to the Ksp. Doing all the similar reactions and calculations that we've done in the past. So let us, and you see a middle box there, concentration of the cations and anions. You're going to need to know that in the interim between the two. So lead chloride is our salt, and I've written the reaction here on the board, and I've given you a value for Ksp, and I'm asking for the molar solubility. So let's just start seeing what is unique about this equilibrium. I want to save myself room for an ICE table. But the next thing I want to do is what I want you to always do when you've written an equilibrium and there's a calculation involved, and that is to write the K expression. In this case, it's called Ksp. What would it be? It would be lead's concentration times chloride's concentration squared, right? Make sure you don't skip this step. Write it out. And then you come up here and you're ready to fill in your table. We're wanting to know the molar solubility. Now the molar solubility is how much of this would dissolve. So what we're going to do is we're going to take ourselves a beaker, okay? We're going to have water in it and we're going to dump a bunch of lead chloride in it. Not very much of it will dissolve. Most of it will sit in the bottom. So I put some into my beaker. Before I put it in, there weren't any of these ions yet, so I put zero there. Now, some of it's going to dissolve. What I'm going to always do here is call that S instead of X. Why? What did S stand for? Look back in your previous, in your notes. S is molar solubility. It is how many moles per liter of this will dissolve. So that's what we'd always see sitting right there is how much of it dissolved? S did. So then we follow this change line across. Nothing different here. I would produce the same amount because it's a 1-to-1. What would you have under here? Well, you produce twice that amount. So I still have some. Why would I still have some? Well, this is an insoluble salt. Look at that K value. Doesn't go very far to the right. So I still have some in there. If I dumped, you know, any significant amount off of a scoop into there, it's going to just dissolve a little bit, so there'll still be some sitting in there. As far as these numbers, we have this. Now we're ready to take our ICE table, our expression we see here, and plug in what we know. Ksp is 2.4 times 10 to the minus 4. Lead is S. Chloride is 2S, but you notice how the chloride is squared? So we have 2.4 times 10 to the minus 4 equals 4S cubed. Now, I've seen people teach this, and I've seen books teach this, in which they skip this, give you this ratio, and say, memorize that. Don't. Do what you know. Write your table, write your expression, plug your values into it, and you can then solve for S. S is the molar solubility by definition. So if I divide by 4, we will end up with a value of 0. Divide by 4, and then what do we have to do? The 4s go away, then we have to take the cube root of that number, okay? Once we divide by 4, we would take the cube root of it. Once we have done that, we will have 0.039, and then we put a unit with it. This is the molarity, the molar solubility, how much would dissolve. Another way you might see this is 3.9 times 10 to the minus 2 moles per liter. We'll just do a capital M. All right, so that is the value of the molar solubility. We've taken it in one direction. Before we leave this problem, can you see how the patterns of things that we've already done play out? The only big difference is I didn't have a number I could put here. I just said I have some. I don't know how much I put in there, but I know there'll still be a lot remaining. That doesn't matter. How much dissolves matter, because that's what molar solubility is. Okay, we'll see what's coming up next. So now we're looking at this problem in which I am giving you the molar solubility and asking you to come up with the Ksp. Remember one of our first slides, we said we're going back and forth. We should be able to go back and forth between these. So what's the first thing I should do? I should write the reaction. So I have MnCO3. I write it on the left as a solid, and the ions that make it up on the right-hand side. Now, you may not have realized that manganese is a plus 2 charge, but you ought to at least know that carbonate is a 2 minus charge. So there is my reaction. I'll leave myself room for an ICE table, and I will write my expression. Ksp is equal to the Mn 2 plus concentration times the carbonate CO3 2 minus concentration. Okay, so I have that. Now, I'm going to go in here and do a similar thing that I did before. In my reaction chamber, I dump some manganese 2 carbonate into a flask. There wasn't any of these ions before it starts dissolving. Some of it's going to dissolve. Always minus X. There will always be a 1 coefficient there. That's how much will dissolve. That, by definition, is the molar solubility. Now, while I'm thinking about it, do I really want to put an S there? Okay, did I tell you what the molar solubility was? Why, yes, I did. So why use a variable? Use the number that they gave me. 4.2 times 10 to the minus 6, not very much, is it, dissolved. Now follow that change line across with the 1 to 1 to 1 coefficient. I am going to have 4.2 times 10 to the minus 6 forming on this side, and I'm going to have 4.2 times 10 to the minus 6 forming under there. Now if I dumped a lot in and a very little bit dissolved, I'd still have some, wouldn't I? And then I have these numbers because I'm adding them to 0 down here in my E line. What am I asked to determine? What's the Ksp? I want to know the value for this. So I'm plugging in what I have. For manganese, it was 4.2 times 10 to the minus 6. For carbonate, it was 4.2 times 10 to the minus 6. So I can just square that number, and I will be left with 1.8 times 10 to the minus 11. Ksp's value. Now, while you put molarities in, and you have to put molarities in for our Ksp's, these are molarities, but Ksp is unitless, so there is no unit associated with that. So now, I have given you one problem in which I gave you the Ksp and asked for molar solubility. I have given you a problem in which I gave you molar solubility and asked for Ksp. Let's see what's next. We're going to work this problem next, and we're not ready to go to the board. Let's just see what's being presented there. I was given a solubility. It doesn't say molar solubility there, does it? It says the solubility, and it gives it in units of grams per liter. You cannot work this problem in grams per liter. You must work it in moles per liter. So that's molar solubility. Let's have you calculate molar solubility. Watch your units. All right, so the right answer is 1.3 times 10 to the minus 19. So now we're going to work on the problem together. Okay, so maybe or maybe you did not get the right answer for the previous one. I showed you what the right answer is. How did I get that? Well, it's a negative 17. That's grams per liter. We realize we don't want the grams, we want moles. And I told you it was 288 grams per mole. So that is where we end up getting the molar solubility given to us is 1.3 times 10 to the minus 19. You need molar solubility to work the problem. Okay, so I have M2X3. I write the reaction. Now, I don't really know what the charges have to be on this, but likely it's some metal with a 3+ charge, and there's two of them, and some anion with a 2- charge, and there's three of them. Okay, so now we have coefficients of 2s and 3s. I'm going to leave room for my ICE table and write my expression. It is an insoluble salt, so it's a Ksp I'm interested in. It is the metal's concentration squared times x^2 - 2 - 2³ power. Okay, so I dump some in to my beaker with water. Before it has a chance to do anything, there isn't any there. Some of this will dissolve. It's always the molar solubility. Now again, I don't need to use an S. We kind of get in the habit of doing S's across there, but I've determined what the molar solubility is. So instead of an S, instead of a variable, I will use the amount that does dissolve, 10 to the minus 19. So I'm going to produce, keep in mind these coefficients, with the acids and bases for the longest time, we didn't have anything but one coefficients. We're back into the world where there are coefficients other than one. So we have to make sure we keep those straight. Now, if a little bit dissolves, we of course still have some sitting in there as a solid. It's not in my equilibrium. When I take this times 2, I'm going to have 2.6 times 10 to the minus 19. And when I take this times 3, I'm going to have 3.9 times 10 to the minus 19. I must have in my calculator. Oh, what is going on here? Oh, I see. My numbers here are going to be a little bit different. 1.3, I had it as 1.25, and I worked my problem with 1.25s. But we can really only know it's a two sig figs anyway, so this will be fine. So my Ksp value is then going to be, I plug in for the M, what's in the E line, 2.6 times 10 to the minus 19, and I square that number. In place of the X, I put its value 3.9 times 10 to the minus 19. And I don't forget to cube. That's why writing this is so important. It reminds me of those powers that I need to put in there. So now when I plug those values into my calculator, I will have 3.3 times 10 to the, wow, it's a hugely, terribly small, is it 93? Yes. Terribly small k. This tells me that hardly anything dissolves. Not even one molecule in a liter will have a chance. You'd have a really, really big flask to get any of it to dissolve on that problem. Okay, so what's up next? What we're going to look at is what's called a common ion situation. We looked at common ion problems when we talked about buffers, but we're going to see the common ion scenario playing out into these equilibria. If you're dissolving this not into water, but into a solution that already contains one of those ions, that's a common ion scenario.